want to welcome everybody for being here today at our weekly media briefing on COVID-19. My name is Ron Aiken. I'm DHEC's Media Relations Director. We're going to start off today with an opening statement from DHEC Medical Consultant, Dr. Jonathan Kanuka. After that, we'll do a Q&A period with written questions that were submitted to us. And then after that, we'll follow it up with a live Q&A. So Dr. Kanuka, thank you so much for being here today, and I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, Ron. Good afternoon, everyone. I want to start today's briefing by sharing some of the latest data from the CDC. As of July 26, more than 163 million people in the U.S. were fully vaccinated against COVID-19. And less than 0.004% of people fully vaccinated against COVID-19 experienced a breakthrough case resulting in hospitalization, and less than 0.001% died from the disease. We do know also that about 74% of these breakthrough cases occurred among those who are 65 and older. And just like our statewide data tells us, this nationwide data is further proof that vaccinations are safe and effective at preventing severe disease and will help us to end this pandemic. I also wanted to offer a little bit of a better breakdown of what it means to be a breakthrough case. Vaccines give the body a competitive advantage against the enemy, in this case, the SARS-CoV-2 virus. So while a vaccine can prevent you from falling ill with COVID-19, there are still some instances when people who have been vaccinated still develop symptoms from the infection. However, the overall goal is to prevent and protect against severe illness and disease. So the point is, breakthrough cases are expected, just like we see with flu vaccine or some of our other vaccines, but the numbers actually show that these COVID-19 vaccines are among the most effective created. That's important to note as we continue pushing for more vaccinations. With the Delta variant on the rise, we've seen that it's more transmissible than SARS, MERS, Ebola, the 1918 Spanish flu, the common cold, and even smallpox. So we have to protect ourselves, the vulnerable individuals of our state, and those who are too young to get vaccinated against this variant. Lastly, I want to recap something from our director, Dr. Simmer, that he noted during Monday's press event for Immunization Awareness Week. South Carolina has lost more than 9,900 residents to COVID-19, and the overwhelming majority of these deaths occurring now are among unvaccinated people, and most of those were during a time when the vaccine was not available. But we now have a solution to end this pandemic, so I encourage you to talk to your doctor, family, and friends about the vaccine. Find credible sources of accurate information, like from the CDC or DHEC websites. Ask questions and become informed. We hope that research leads to a decision to get vaccinated. Either of the three authorized vaccines will save your life and the lives of those you care about. With that, I'm going to turn it back over to Ron.
Thank you, Dr. Kanuka. I'm going to go through the pre-submitted questions that we have. First off, does DHEC have a response to the provisos included in the state budget preventing schools from enforcing mask mandates? And does DHEC think masks should be a requirement and not just an option?
So any decision to change the proviso rests with our political leaders. Obviously, when the initial decision was made and the regulation passed, we were not where we are today when it comes to the number of COVID-19 cases and the hospitalizations from the Delta variant. So it's important to note that changing recommendations such as mask wearing are expected when situations change. Our job as public health agency is to make sure that best decisions are based on what the science and data are telling us. That being said, DHEC recognizes the mask use cannot be mandated per the South Carolina General Assembly and will adhere to the state law, and we advise others to do the same. But we still strongly recommend mask use for all people when indoors in school settings, especially when physical distancing is not possible.
Thank you. Next question is, should immunocompromised people who are fully vaccinated start wearing masks again?
Yeah, so we recommend that everyone follow the updated guidance provided by the CDC about face mask use in general. Based on the current rates of COVID disease and risk of transmission in South Carolina, most people should wear face masks while they're indoors in public, and that includes immunocompromised people.
Next question is, how often should a vaccinated individual be getting themselves tested?
The CDC now says that fully vaccinated people who know they were exposed to someone with confirmed COVID-19 or suspected COVID-19 should get tested for the virus 3 to 5 days after they were exposed.
Gotcha. Our next question is, we have had some people reach out to us about the delays in testing results at DHEC sites. How many rapid free testing sites does DHEC have? And does DHEC plan to open up more as the variant spreads? Is DHEC seeing a shortage of COVID-19 tests?
DHEC does not have any rapid free testing sites at the moment, but on average on any given day, DHEC sponsors 55 to 60 free testing events across the state. All of DHEC's testing sites offer either nasal or saliva PCR testing with results available within about 48 hours. At this moment, we're not setting up additional test sites because we believe the testing opportunities we currently have available can meet the increasing demand. However, we're constantly evaluating demand and responding appropriately, and we're not seeing a shortage of COVID-19 tests at this time.
COVID-19 testing rates are climbing, but so is the percent positive. How much more testing does the state need to be doing to address this case spike?
High percent positivity occurs when many of the test results among those being tested and reported in a community are positive. So this can mean a few things. It could mean there are widespread infections in the community being tested. Could be that only those at greatest risk of an infection within a community are being tested. Or there might be reporting processes or delays that skew the results. So an example would be including if somebody prioritizes or an agency prioritizes reporting positive results over negative results. Overall, the percent positive is one indicator we look at to determine the overall impact that COVID-19 is having on our state, but there are other indicators like the case rate, hospitalizations, and deaths that give us a fuller picture of what's going on. So we continue to support vaccines as the best defense against beating this pandemic and getting our numbers back down.
Thank you. Do you know, or do we know, if the testing spike can be attributed to vaccinated or unvaccinated individuals? Has DHEC and others seen an increase in testing demand? If so, do we have plans to ramp up testing again?
Looking at the data we provided on July 23rd in our news release, the majority of our newly reported cases are among unvaccinated people. Since we know that those infected by COVID-19 can be both symptomatic and asymptomatic, DHEC supports CDC's recommendations about COVID-19 testing. So people who have symptoms of COVID-19 should get tested. People who have had close contact with someone with confirmed COVID-19 should get tested. Unvaccinated people who've been taking part in activities that put them at higher risk for COVID-19, where they couldn't physically distance, should get tested. And people who've been asked or referred to get tested by their healthcare provider.
Has DHEC seen a noticeable increase in the number of vaccinations across the state? And if so, where in South Carolina, and why do you think that is?
Yes, we have seen a recent uptick in vaccinations across the state, and we hope that that trend continues. It's difficult to pinpoint exactly why that is, but we hope that it's because people have maybe done more research or they've noticed there's an uptick in cases in their family or their community, and they decided to go ahead and protect themselves and others by getting vaccinated. If we look back historically, this happens as well when outbreaks of other vaccine preventable diseases occur, like from pertussis or measles, people go ahead and get vaccinated.
Thank you. It's kind of a two-part question. With the SC Strong program, first, how were the people chosen to participate, and what are DHEC and USC hoping to learn from the participants? And if the study is to figure out if you have COVID-19 antibodies, wouldn't everyone vaccinated have antibodies? And if so, can those who have been vaccinated participate, or is it just to those who have had COVID?
So good question. Participants were randomly selected to help us get a better idea of what was going on with people who were infected in South Carolina. And we hope to have evidence-based information on current viral infection rates and a level of antibody protection from naturally acquired infection or versus immunity from vaccination. This information will help make better data-driven decisions among our key health authorities. So the goal of the South Carolina Strong Project was to understand the true number of people in South Carolina who've been infected with SARS-CoV-2 virus, so we can strengthen our state responding to the virus now and develop better, more informed plans. The antibodies that South Carolina Strong looked at were specifically to document previous infection by looking for antibodies to part of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, called the nucleocapsid. Antibodies to the spike protein that come from vaccination were not included in that study.
Thank you. Does DHEC have any recommendations for nursing homes or assisted living facilities regarding visitation and also testing for visitors and or employees?
So DHEC's current visitation guidelines state that facilities are required to allow visitation, including indoor visits, outdoor visits, compassionate care visits, window visits, and virtual visits. Facilities may use a scheduling system to stagger visitation to ensure that all residents are able to receive visitors and to ensure they are maintaining the core principles of infection control. Compassionate care visits must be allowed at all times for all residents. And if there's anybody who has a concern that a facility isn't properly following the new visitation guidelines, they can reach out and or submit a complaint to DHEC, and DHEC will follow up and investigate that if appropriate. There's also guidelines from CMS regarding testing of employees routinely, and that depends on the disease transmission of COVID-19 in the community.
Thank you. Do we know if breakthrough cases are happening more frequently to people with compromised immune systems?
We've known since the start of the pandemic that COVID-19 is especially hard on those who have pre-existing medical conditions and those who are 65 and older. So to that point, the recent CDC data shows that almost 3/4 of the breakthrough cases nationwide have occurred among those who are 65 and older.
Since it's more contagious, does the Delta variant require a better mask than prior variants?
At this time, the masks currently recommended by the CDC are appropriate for the current variant circulating in our community, including the Delta variant. I think what matters most is making sure that masks are worn consistently and properly, that it covers the mouth and the nose.
Is there anything different about the metrics surge we're seeing now compared to those prior in the pandemic?
Yes, the CDC is attributing recent increases in cases to the rise of the Delta variant, which wasn't the case earlier in the pandemic, obviously. As the viruses mutate into different forms over time, they can become stronger, which essentially is, you know, what these variants are. So with the rise of the Delta variant, which causes one person to infect about 4 times as many people as the previous variants, combined with lagging vaccination rates, that's resulted in significantly more cases in South Carolina and across the country.
Do kids exhibit any coronavirus symptoms that are typically not presented by adults?
Kids mostly experience similar symptoms as adults. And while the disease severity from the Delta variant doesn't appear worse than other variants for children thus far, the Delta variant is significantly more infectious than the previous variants. So with it being, you know, more infectious than MERS and SARS and flu and the cold and Ebola and so forth, that means it can infect more children, and that will lead to more cases in children, MIS-C cases, hospitalizations, and death among kids, unfortunately.
All right, we have 2 more written questions. What kind of COVID-19 clusters is DHEC investigating at the moment? Summer camp outbreaks, workplace outbreaks, et cetera. Could you give us some insight into what clusters are driving the state's disease spread?
COVID-19 is widespread in South Carolina among those who are most vulnerable, and the best actions to prevent further spread is vaccinations. We're currently investigating all cases and close contacts and providing information to the venues regarding how to decrease transmission. When an infectious disease is spread and individuals who are not taking appropriate precautions to limit the disease transmission, it's difficult to determine with certainty where and when an individual may have been infected with COVID-19. It could have been at school, it could have been an activity or another venue that put them at risk. The key message is to remember that what puts you at risk most personally and is from activities, what puts you at risk both personally from activities that puts you at increased risk.
And our final pre-submitted question, does DHEC have a list of every lab performing whole genome sequencing on SARS-CoV-2 samples from South Carolina?
Yes, DHEC knows there are a number of private labs that have the ability to perform whole genome sequencing, and those include LabCorp, Mako Labs, Veterans Administration Medical Center, Quest Diagnostics, Medical University of South Carolina, Jackson Laboratories, Premier Laboratories, Aegis Sciences Corp, Fulgent Laboratory, Gravity Laboratory, and Helix Laboratory. Additionally, the DHEC Public Health Lab, which is not a private lab, also reports whole genome sequencing results to our surveillance system.
Thank you so much for answering those pre-submitted questions and for everybody who did submit them. Before we open it up for our live question portion, I do want to remind everyone that the purpose of this briefing is to inform and educate the public on the status of COVID-19 in South Carolina and answer any questions you may have about it. Any requests or questions about other issues than COVID should go through our normal media channels. If you have a question, please raise your hand virtually and wait to be called on by me. And I'd also add that a recording of today's briefing will be available this afternoon on our YouTube page. Questions for Dr. Konecka, we'll start with Chris Joseph.
Thanks for the time, Doctor. So I guess to restate a question from earlier, what is your sense of South Carolina's testing situation? Are we doing enough testing to have a sense of how broad this surge is?
Yeah, as I said earlier, I don't think that we're falling behind right now. We're obviously monitoring the situation to see if there's any shortcomings or further need to adjust our approach. But as of right now, we feel comfortable with the testing availability that's out there.
Go ahead, Timmy Aboy.
Does making masking optional strip away a layer of protection because not everyone wears one?
Yes, one of the most effective ways to prevent the spread of COVID-19, apart from being vaccinated, is to wear a face mask. And that's been well documented in the literature. So I think obviously with the more infectious Delta variant spreading around the community, it's more important than ever for people to wear their face masks in public, in closed, in indoor settings.
Chris, do you still have a question?
As a follow-up, thank you. So in terms of the spiking percent positive, then it does seem like there are several factors at play here, but I am curious, what is DHEC's sense of why it's present and why it's jumped so dramatically?
Well, I think it's important to note that the Delta variant is significantly more transmissible. So the earlier versions, if somebody had COVID-19, they would maybe infect one or two other people. With the current Delta variant, we're seeing that number being closer to 8 or 9, which puts it on level with chickenpox, which is very infectious disease. So I think we're seeing a much more transmissible variant in the community, in a community that's not fully protected, that has relatively low vaccination rates, to be frank. And so I think we're going to continue to see the numbers go up among the most vulnerable in our community and among the unvaccinated and children.
Tamia, did you have a follow-up?
Yes. Should it be a personal choice to wear a mask if your choice impacts the entire community?
That's a good question. Obviously, in public health, we are concerned with ensuring that what people practice individually keeps those around them safe. And so that's why there are certain requirements for attending school. Kids have to get certain vaccines to protect those around them. So, we want people to be mindful of their individual actions and how that impacts those around them, impacts their neighbors, their children, people at their church, and so forth. So what every person does individually impacts those around them. And I think that's important for us to remember to show appropriate care and concern for our neighbors and our friends and our loved ones.
Sam, go ahead.
Hey, thanks for taking the question, Doctor. I know you mentioned that vaccinations are rising as cases surge. I'm curious, are there any particular parts of the state where you've seen a significant amount of renewed interest in vaccines?
Unfortunately, I don't have that information in front of me to be able to tell you, but we could get it and we could follow up with you, Ron, or somebody else in our communications team could follow up with you on that, but I don't have that information in front of me right now.
Zaria Jeffries, welcome.
Thank you. So my question is, since access to the vaccine is no longer an issue, why are we seeing such low vaccination rates for people ages 20 to 24 or below the age of 30?
I think it's probably multifactorial. I think that there's might be a perception about people's risk that in general, people who are younger have done better from COVID-19 compared to people who are elderly or have other underlying medical conditions. I think some people might be reluctant as well, waiting for final approval from the FDA on these vaccines. But I think it's important to recognize that literally hundreds of millions of people in the U.S. and worldwide have been vaccinated with these vaccines. It's proved to be very safe and extremely effective at preventing COVID-19. So I think that's, our message and encouragement to the young people out there.
Chris, you have a follow-up?
Yes. We've gotten several questions from viewers as to if and when DHEC might be presenting data, on a vaccinated versus unvaccinated basis. Does DHEC have any plans to do that? And if so, what might that timeline be?
I don't have a timeline for you on that. That is something that we're looking at. Obviously, we've been reporting different rates of breakthrough cases and numbers. And so obviously that's something we look at, but also what other cases are going on as far as repeat infections and so forth. So that's something that we're actively looking at, but I don't know exactly how or when we're going to communicate that.
Tamia, go ahead, please.
Thank you. Will we be seeing another surge as schools are, you know, beginning and masks aren't really required and neither are vaccinations? If you're able to answer that, at least.
I mean, I don't have a crystal ball to know exactly what's going to happen in the schools this fall, but I do think we can look at other places around the world that have already opened up. I'm thinking of Israel, for example, where they have essentially doubled the vaccination rate among their adults, and they still had cases and outbreaks that happened in their schools. And even in South Carolina already, where some schools have already started to reopen, there have been cases of COVID-19 and people having to go into isolation and quarantine already. So I think that's the real risk and that's a real concern. And obviously, if children and staff aren't wearing masks, that increases that risk. I mean, I hope that parents recognize the situation is different than it was in the past and take that to heart. You know, in South Carolina, we're very well versed in hurricane season. And so it's one thing to say a tropical storm is coming and prepare for that. And then when it changes and they say, actually, it's going to be a Category 4, you make a different decision than what you might have made when it was a lower risk. So I hope that people recognize that the situation has changed and adjust their decisions and their practices accordingly.
And I just want to note that Chris, our communications director, Christy Moore, put in the chat that information you're asking about will be available the week of August the 16th. Zaria, or is it Zaria? You tell me how to pronounce it correctly.
It's Zaria.
Zaria. Okay, go ahead, please.
So do we know if once infected by this Delta variant, if people are being hospitalized at a faster rate than previous variants, or is the timeline sort of similar?
I'm not sure on the timeline. I do know that the rates of hospitalizations are definitely going up. About 10% of inpatients right now are COVID patients, whereas 2 weeks ago it was less than 4%. And the overall number of people in hospital from COVID right now is about 3 times what it was 2 weeks ago. So certainly as the numbers are going up, we're seeing more people in hospital, more people in the ICU.
Chris, go ahead, sir.
You referenced obviously keeping tabs on the testing situation, and if the DHEC feels like it needs to add more options, no doubt it will. I'm curious, do you have a threshold in mind, or does DHEC have a threshold in mind as to when we might need to put more resources toward that situation?
That would be something a decision we would make in conjunction with some of our partners around the state. Obviously, we're not the only place that does testing. There's a lot of private vendors that are doing testing in healthcare systems around the state. So I think that would be a decision we make in conjunction with some of our other partners and vendors that we're subcontracting with and see what they're seeing on the ground and what their capacity is.
Anything else, Chris? Or go ahead, Zari.
I noticed that you mentioned a lot of the mask mandates were handled by political figures in South Carolina, but is DHEC in conversation with some of those people about South Carolina's rankings nationwide about vaccinations?
Yeah, so our leadership in DHEC is in conversation with other agencies, and that includes the Department of Education as well as the governor's office about what we're seeing and what our place is nationally, locally, and what we think the best practices are.
Anybody else have any questions for Dr. Kanuka? Chris, go ahead.
Sorry to play ping pong here with some of the other journalists, but all right, so we know that this information is, I guess, coming out in the next week or two related to vaccinated or unvaccinated. And perhaps this might be a better question for Christy, but I'll ask anyway. Is that going to change DHEC's messaging game plan? I know that's been a point of emphasis talking about unvaccinated deaths of late in some of these calls. Is that going to be an active part of your messaging moving forward?
I think we'll have to look at the information and the data and kind of see what it shows, but I think it will underscore what we've already been saying, and that's that people who are unvaccinated are the greatest risk for contracting COVID. They're the majority of the ones who are currently getting COVID and being hospitalized from it and dying from it. So I don't think that's necessarily going to change. And we already do know that people have repeat infections from COVID-19, and I think the variant puts people at risk of that occurring more now than ever before.
Anything else, Chris? Any further questions?
I guess I would just add on to that last comment I gave to you, Kristen, and say that even though people who've been infected before still are at risk for potentially contracting COVID-19 again, they do have some level of protection for a period of time, and antibodies can wane over time, which we know obviously from natural infection or from immunity. And so that's why we encourage people, even if they've had COVID-19 before, to get vaccinated, because we know that'll give them a boost in their antibodies and more effective antibodies to what's circulating right now in the community.
Dr. Knoche, thank you so much for your time today. For all the journalists on the line, thank you all so much for taking part and for your questions. We appreciate your time. You can follow back up with us after this is over through our email channels, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you, Doctor.